Hello, this is Claudio Perez from El País, the Spanish Daily. A Catalan question, if I may. Would the Spanish Supreme Court have any ground for asking the Court of Justice if the European arrest warrant is being correctly applied by Germany regarding Puigdemont case?
Well, here again, whether the Spanish Supreme Court has any ground or not, that is only for the Spanish Supreme Court to decide. This is a matter of Spanish law. I cannot even pronounce on that. I mean, this is for that court to decide. The only thing I can say is, when it does ask a question on the interpretation of the European Union legislation on the European arrest warrant, then my answer is the same than to the Brexit question there. Since we have compulsory jurisdiction, we must take all the cases which have been validly brought before us. So if a Supreme Court of a member state, Spain or any other member state, refers a matter on interpretation of union law, such a request is in principle admissible. I say in principle because we have a sort of caveat in our case law when the case is hypothetical or wholly construed, but that is of course inimaginable from a Supreme Court of a member state, whatever a member state it be, by the way. Sometimes you can have a construed litigation before a very low and local judge. That we have had a few such cases. That goes back to the, for the experts among you, the Foglia Novello line of cases of the 1980s. But that was of very low courts bringing cases to us. But from a Supreme Court, that is not imaginable. So we have compulsory jurisdiction. That's the answer. When a case comes, we must interpret union law, never national law, only union law. We cannot pronounce on Spanish law, on German law, on Belgian law, on Irish law, on Dutch law. That's why the case from the Netherlands is not coming to us, because it's still dealt with as a matter of Dutch law. So there is a strict separation of competences between the national courts and our court. But it works remarkably well. When the national courts have sorted out their case, then the matter comes to us, and we can then cleanly decide the European Union law matters. And especially having references from Supreme Courts facilitates the dialogue, because the Supreme Court has the final authority on national law. So then we know precisely and definitively in which national law context the problem of European Union law arises. And we can then give a very focused, a very targeted answer to be useful to the court. So when I spoke about an interaction, a dialogue between equals, I really mean it. That is how it works.
Paddy Smith, also from Ireland, the Irish Times, and a much more pedestrian question. I'm probably a stupid question, but I have written regularly about the rulings of the court and of the opinions of the court. And when writing about the opinions of the court, I used the formula which is usually followed by the court itself. And I just wondered if you have any statistics about the extent to which the opinions are then supported by the decisions of the court, the full court.
Yeah, that is... That's an excellent question, which comes back all the time. The answer is difficult to give, and this for two reasons. And this is not a matter of sort of ducking the question. I mean, it's objectively difficult. Because the law is not a binary thing either or. So in other words, it's possible that the Advocate General advocates a particular solution to the case, but over a legal reasoning which the court does not adhere to, but by a wholly different way, it comes maybe to the same outcome. And then the question is, do you follow or do you not follow? And I say this, that's the first reason. The second reason is that, as I said in my introductory statement, we have for two-thirds of all our cases are preliminary references. And a preliminary reference is an in the operative part of the judgment, you give an interpretation of union law. So the interpretation has shades to it, has limits and conditions to it. So in other words, it may well be that there is some coincidence with what the Advocate General proposes, but also some sizable deviations in the same interaction. So it is objectively difficult to find the way. Now, if you were nevertheless, in spite of these two caveats, to try to say it, then I would offer you the following as a sort of a key of analysis of opinions being followed or not. The bigger the bench is, the smaller the percentage of opinions being wholly followed. All right? So if you have grand chamber cases, the opinions are more often not followed than when you have 5 judge chambers or an opinion in a 3 judge chamber case. Now, why is that so? And you have plenty of examples of this. I mean, even of the cases which I have been mentioning here, you see sizable differences between the opinion of the Advocate General and the bench. Why? It's very simple. Law is not mathematics. It's not an either-or thing, right or wrong. Reasonable lawyers can come to different legal reasonings and different conclusions. If that were not so, there would not be cases in the first place, because you would apply a computer-steered mathematical model to the one right outcome, like in algebra. But case law and jurisprudence is not algebra. So reasonable lawyers can continue till the punchline to differ of opinion. Now, when a case is sent to the Grand Chamber in our court, that is really the cases, constitutional bench cases, the cases where the spread of opinions, in the case of thoughts, of insights, is at the start very wide, very open-ended. You say, well, maybe this, maybe this, like this. The cases you mentioned, for instance, goes to the Grand Chamber. The reference for a preliminary ruling by the Bundesverfassungsgericht on the quantitative easing program, the aspect of the purchase program by the European Central Bank of these public bonds on the secondary market. Cases like that, Grand Chamber. In these cases, they are so wide to begin with, many sub-questions, that the statistical chance that on all these questions and sub-questions you come out each time on the same side is, for obvious reasons, smaller than when you have a more technical aspect of a value-added tax case, where it's a matter of really going deeply into the technicalities of the case, make a reasoned proposal, and which will probably correspond to the common sense, possibly also of a small bench. But NICAP, competence of the Union vis-à-vis the member states to conclude CETA, to conclude TTIP, Singapore, ISDS, rule of law, transparency of documents of the several legislative and administrative processes, etc., etc. That is, all these questions of which also she spoke, the sensitive questions which might be also divisive in a societal context, there it's quite clear that the statistical chance of the opinion not being followed is much bigger. So that you should realize. I would say for the Grand Chamber 50-50. For the others, probably 3/4 for the other benches. But that's a hunch feeling, and with the caveats I said at the start.
Hello. Petra von Willersdorf, Slovenian News Agency. I have a question about cases member state versus member state on the basis of Article 259 in the context of Slovenian-Croatian issue of the implementation of the internet of the border arbitration award on the border between the countries. It's a twofold question. First, given that there are not a lot of cases, there haven't been a lot of cases so far, only six, I think, and one active case, could you maybe walk us through, tell us a little bit about characteristics of these cases? Like, how long does it usually take to get to the judgment? And how important is the role of the commission in this process? Because the commission has always been on the side of the winner, if I may so say so so far. But in this case, one of the sides has doubts about the commission acting in good faith. So maybe if you can explain a bit the role of the commission. And the second part of this question, if you could maybe comment this specific case, there's been a lot of controversy also over the jurisdiction of the court. So is the court competent? I mean, can you decide in this case when it's actually about the arbitration award of an ad hoc tribunal? Thank you.
Yeah, I'm very much aware of the context of the case because I visited right before Christmas the Supreme Courts in both Slovenia and Croatia. It's again this informal aspect of the dialogue between the courts. And of course, in the social context, they somehow explain to us what is really at stake, just between colleague judges in a social context. So I see about what you mean. Now, you refer to Article 259 TFEU, but I'm not totally sure that is really the article you are meaning to use, to mention. Why? 259 is the article offering the possibility for a member state to bring before the court, after a pre-contentious procedure has been respected, etc., and now pass the details, to bring another member state to the Court of Justice for infringement of European Union law proper. And then, of course, you need to have a principle or a rule of the EU treaties or of the Charter of Fundamental Rights or of one of the regulations or directives, a norm of union law, which is compulsory, of course, for the defendant member state like for any other member state, and which, in view of the applicant member state, has been breached. Now, of that sort, since the 1950s, we have had not many cases, but at least between 5 and 10 or something. So I don't think that is what you are thinking of. You are thinking of Article 273 of the treaty. You can maybe note it, 273. And 273 is the possibility for member states to submit to the Court of Justice a dispute between them on a matter which is not strictly speaking union law, but which is relevant for the, let's say, for the loyalty between member states, for the European Union, more broadly speaking. So that is wider. And there it is true that there is one case decided. That is the Austria-Germany case, decided in 2017, by the way. And that's a splendid example of it. It was a matter of taxing income from interests in the revenue tax in Germany. And Austria contended that this was contrary to a provision of the double taxation treaty, that is prevention of double taxation treaty, between Austria and Germany. Again, these tax conventions are not union law. And normally our court has no jurisdiction to interpret and enforce these conventions. Except, and now we are there, when the two member states agree to submit that dispute between them on a bilateral treaty between them, to our judgment, which is of course in that case binding. That is the very first case imagine, Grand Chamber, of course, because it was a novelty. Grand Chamber, 15 judges. Austria against Germany, and Austria won. And there we said, well, we are not applying union law there. Eh? We apply public international law, that convention, and all the rest. But we accepted that it came in our jurisdiction because the dispute, of course, involved investments of investors of one member state in another member state, and it was sufficiently linked to the object of union law, but the dispute submitted to us was not union law proper. And so, either way, I do not know the case technically, but if one of these two member states can point to a provision of union law which is breached, allegedly breached, in whatever field, I do not see immediately which one, but I mean, that's not for me to find out, then it could be a 259 case. But there have been, again, in the whole life of the court, I have not counted them exactly, between 5 and 10, I guess. There have been cases on wine between Belgium and Spain. There has been cases on voting rights on Gibraltar between Spain and the UK. You know these cases. But then you have the other track. And so the two should be distinguished. But either way, when the case, again, that's then direct actions, it's for once not an example of a preliminary reference, but when such cases come, and when they come in the purview of respectively Article 259 or 273, then of course the court has compulsory jurisdiction, always the same baseline, and we must pronounce.
Soy Antonio Delgado de la Radio Publique Espagnole. Je voulais revenir sur les cas catalans. Juste pour clarifier, quand vous dites qu'en principe serait admissible une question préjudiciaire dans un tribunal suprême, comme vous savez, il y a eu une forte controverse parce qu'en purité, c'est un mandat d'arrêt qui est en train d'être jugé en Allemagne, dont la procédure sera en Allemagne. Il y a qui dit que si on lit les papiers, les règles de procédure préjudiciaire, c'est à la cour qui est en train de décider de se prononcer. Et à part de ça, j'imagine que vous allez vous prononcer sur les cas en question particulier, mais je crois savoir qu'il y a une forte large jurisprudence de la cour sur les mandats d'arrêt et spécifiquement sur la question de si pour des délits qui sont dehors de la liste automatique, il faut juger que les codes pénals aussi entrent dans les fonds. Donc je ne sais pas si vous pouvez nous donner un petit peu un certain flavor de la jurisprudence.
Oui, ça je peux certainement faire. Donc, je ne peux évidemment rien dire sur un cas lorsqu'il est pendant, mais a fortiori pas lorsqu'il n'est pas encore pendant et peut-être sera pendant. Donc là, il faut évidemment toujours voir le cas en tant que tel, ça va de soi. Et comme je disais, s'il est pendant, comme le président Jaeger le disait aussi, là nous ne pouvons plus rien dire dessus. Mais en général, comme vous le savez, il y a la fameuse liste de 12 infractions qui, en tant que telle, et sans que la condition de la double incrimination joue telle qu'elle, hein, sont du ressort de la décision cadre sur le mandat d'arrêt européen. Et donc, pour ces infractions-là, l'autorité judiciaire d'exécution, comme on l'appelle ça techniquement, est obligée de mettre en œuvre le mandat d'arrêt européen. Pour toutes les autres incriminations, là, effectivement, on a fait, donc, mais c'est le législateur, hein, ce n'est pas la Cour de justice. Là, j'insiste, c'est très important de ne pas confondre. Là, le législateur de l'Union européenne a exigé la condition ou a imposé la condition de la fameuse double incrimination. Et la raison en est, et je dis ça en général, parce que juste pour que vous compreniez que c'est très sensible et en même temps très important. Le droit pénal matériel n'est pas harmonisé du tout. Le droit procédural pénal, en réalité non plus, mais quand même, là, il y a un certain nombre de règles qui sont harmonisées. Par exemple, le fait que à partir du premier interrogatoire de la police, vous devez, comme personne soupçonnée, avoir la possibilité de vous faire assister par un avocat, c'est en fait la mise en œuvre de la jurisprudence salle douce de la Cour européenne des droits de l'homme. Ça a été fait au niveau de l'Union européenne par une directive de 2013. Hein. C'est un aspect d'harmonisation de la procédure pénale des États membres. Il y a d'autres aspects. C'est ponctuel, mais quand même important. Mais le droit pénal matériel n'a aucunement été harmonisé. Et j'insiste là-dessus parce que ça veut dire donc que l'éventail de faits criminels, je dirais, d'actes criminels, cet éventail, il est presque sans limite. Il est très large et sans limite. Et on a voulu éviter qu'un État membre soit obligé de mettre en œuvre un mandat d'arrêt européen lorsque le prétendu délit en vue duquel on demande la remise d'une telle personne est presque choquant quant à son existence dans le chef de l'autorité judiciaire d'exécution. C'est ça le vrai problème. Et il y a, par exemple, pour vous illustrer ça, il y a des délits dans le domaine de l'euthanasie ou de l'avortement. Non, mais sérieux, voire même des jeux de hasard où il y a des sanctions pénales dans certains États membres, mais pas du tout dans les autres. Au contraire, c'est même encouragé. Donc les divergences de choix de société, finalement, peuvent être énormes. Et donc l'exigence de la double incrimination, c'est pour faire ça. Maintenant, le problème méthodologique, c'est que lorsqu'il n'y a pas d'harmonisation au niveau de l'Union, c'est forcément le droit national qui est pertinent. Mais le droit national, je vous le disais déjà, il n'appartient pas à la Cour de justice d'interpréter le droit national. Donc, l'exigence de la double incrimination va, en fin de compte, reposer sur une appréciation en droit comparé, si vous voulez, par une autorité judiciaire d'exécution entre la similitude, à tout le moins similitude suffisante, entre le prétendu délit en vue duquel on a demandé la remise d'une personne et l'équivalent qui existerait dans le droit propre. Mais ça n'est aucunement réglé dans la législation de l'Union européenne qui se borne à dire il faut que ce délit corresponde. Donc nous n'avons pas encore eu de cas. Et je ne dis pas que la Cour ne peut être aucunement utile, mais c'est normal qu'on n'ait pas eu de cas parce que c'est en principe une appréciation en droit national et en droit comparé. Mais encore une fois, comme je l'ai dit déjà, la réalité dépasse de loin l'imagination de l'homme. Donc lorsqu'on aura un jour des affaires, celle à laquelle vous faites allusion ou une autre, ça va venir sans doute. Mais nous n'avons pas encore de jurisprudence là-dessus. Et la difficulté méthodologique est celle-là, que ça n'a pas été harmonisé ou réglé au niveau européen.
Et sur la question de l'admissibilité, est-ce qu'on peut...
Oui, mais l'admissibilité, ça c'est dès lors qu'une juridiction nationale pose une question relative au droit de l'Union. Ça c'est une proposition tout à fait générale. Cette question est recevable. Donc,
c'est une procédure dans un autre État membre qui est concernée.
Oui, mais ça c'est un peu, comment dirais-je maintenant, je ne dois pas ici inventer, il y a des contextes procéduraux pensables, hein, tant dans l'État membre où l'autorité judiciaire émet le mandat, dans votre exemple, ça sera l'Espagne, ou dans l'État membre dans lequel l'autorité judiciaire doit juger de l'exécution du mandat, dans les deux États membres concernés, il y a quand même dans les procédures respectivement pendant des points de contact avec cette législation européenne qui, dans les deux cas, peuvent conduire à des renvois préjudiciels. Cela étant dit, je dois vous admettre que jusqu'ici, j'ai fait le survol rapide de notre jurisprudence. À ma connaissance, toutes les questions préjudicielles qu'on a reçues jusqu'ici émanent toutes de l'autorité judiciaire d'exécution. Ce sont les deux cas irlandais dont on parlait, mais plein d'autres. Hein, donc l'affaire Mantello, l'affaire Aragnosi-Caldararo que j'ai mentionné, c'est toujours l'autorité judiciaire d'exécution. Mais ça ne veut pas dire que, bon, le mandat d'arrêt européen, ça existe 15 ans. Hein, donc je veux dire, le droit se développe, donc on ne peut jamais prédire toutes les affaires qui pourraient encore venir.
Hein. Merci. Au fond, hi, Tom Nuttall from The Economist. There was a preliminary judgment in a case involving the Portuguese judiciary in late February, which included some very strong language emphasizing the importance of national judiciaries being able to maintain independence from external sources of pressure. And as you may know, that has been interpreted in some quarters as a sign that the court is, as it were, itching for an opportunity to express an opinion on the extent to which judiciaries in some countries, not Portugal in particular, may have been compromised by such sources of pressure. I wondered if you could give us a steer on whether that's a correct interpretation.
Well, I'm very happy that you mentioned the judgment of the Sindicación, the Juízes Portugueses. It's a judgment, I say it for everyone, of the 27th of February 2018. And I'm happy that you mentioned the judgment because, in my view, it is one of the most fundamental judgments handed down in recent times. Because it explicits very clearly the values of Article 2 of the Treaty on the European Union, and especially the rule of law value. And we have linked it with Article 19 of the Treaty on the European Union, where the member states are obliged to provide for effective judicial protection of the rights and obligations flowing from European Union law. So we have, in that case, not just gone out of our way, like you might maybe suggest, but I think we have very legitimately set a stage for judging the effectiveness of the judicial protection which member states must organize for the enforcement of rights and obligations flowing from union law. You all know in this room that, different from the United States of America, the European Union, and for the better, I think, has no district courts and circuit courts of appeal all over the territory, federal courts, that is, of the European Union. In other words, it is the national courts, it's also a matter of subsidiarity in a way, huh? The national courts which enforce and apply union law. And a bit under the motto, what is good enough for national law to be enforced and applied should be good enough for union law in that very same member state. That is what, in very sophisticated terms, we call the principle of procedural equivalence. Right, the remedies available in the domestic legal system, judicial remedies available, are the same for national law and union law in that particular member state. However, we said that being a member state of the European Union and being obliged under Article 19 to offer such judicial protection, effective judicial protection of the rights and obligations flowing from union law, implies independent and impartial courts which satisfy the age-old criteria of our Vasen-Goebbels case law, a 1966 case, determining what is a court or tribunal of a member state with a view to engaging precisely in this preliminary reference dialogue with the Court of Justice. So what we have done in this Juízes Portugueses case is to update and to solidify the criterion of independence and impartiality, which is center stage since 1966 in our case law. Now, the sole reason why we did so, and believe me, please, because it's the truth, is that the reference coming from the Supreme Administrative Court in Lisbon, it asked whether the austerity measures limiting temporarily the salaries or reducing temporarily the salaries of the judges in Portugal was an encroachment or not on judicial independence. So in order to rule on the substance on that of that matter, we had to define first what judicial independence entails. And once having done that, and you're quite right, in very strong, precise, and committing language, as it should be, I think, for all courts, in our network of courts, which is basically the judicial apparatus of the European Union, as I explained, then, of course, we measured whether these austerity measures were a breach of that or not. And we said it was not, and we say why. Now, of course, it's always so that our judgments have relevance way beyond the case in which the pronouncements are made. And that is especially so in references for preliminary rulings. That is why I said the ruling is not just relevant for the member state whose court it was referring the matter to us in the first place. That is why every reference is translated into the 24 languages. All the member states have the right to participate in the procedure, and so on and so forth. That's the reality. But of course, the fact that some read this and say, hey, that makes us think also of some other member state, that's an outside observation which is totally understandable, but that is never something which drives the court as such. We really deal with each case on its own merits and its own foundation.
Irina Sommer, Ukrainian news agency UNIAN. Can you please give us a general picture on the cases regarding restricted measure introduced by European Union because of the situation in and around Ukraine, and also for former Ukrainian top people? And second part of the question, because a few people of Ukrainian list won in your court, don't you think that counsel did a bad job in this case? Thank you.
Well, I'm looking to my colleague Mark Jaeger because, of course, as he explained very clearly in his introductory statement, the first judicial engagement with these issues is in the general court, and then on appeal there are some cases coming to us, but especially the sanctions taken against, for instance, Russian interests after their engagement in the Donbass region. I think that has more been the case in the general court. I don't know, Mark, whether you could...
Yes. Now, I do not have in mind numbers of how many decisions were taken concerning restrictive measures implying directly or indirectly your country. The general picture is quite basically the same whatever is the country involved. There is a decision by the European Union, and the persons or companies on the list can act against this decision. That they are on the list and by that have asset freezed and so on and so far. And we just check whether these decisions are legal. So we have an we are an administrative judge. We check legality. And if the decisions have been adopted correctly in the legal framework, by containing a reasoning, by respecting the procedure, by and so on and so far, then we say, okay, it is correct or it is not correct. And then the decision goes back to the European Union, and they can do what they want in order to execute the decision. Our decision, I mean our judgment. Now, if these decisions, I haven't got exactly your second question. If all our decisions where we annulled were taken once again by the...
A few Ukrainians won against counsel in your court. So don't you think that counsel in this case did a bad job?
From a legal point of view, Of course, because there was a good reason why we had annulled the decision. Mm. Now, that's from the legal point of view. I do not want to do any appreciation from the moral point of view. Yes or no, I don't know. It's not.
You should know, and totally on the same line as President Jaeger, you may be aware of the Kadi line of cases, which of course have nothing to do with Ukrainian nationals being the subject of sanctions, but it sets the legal standards which the council must satisfy to do, in legal terms, what you call a good job. That is, the council should reason the listing and should also, in case of litigation, case of challenge brought against the listing decision by the persons concerned, be capable of producing, possibly in camera, that is, taking into account all security interests, because there might be witnesses to be protected, sources to be protected, and the court is now equipped with a special security room where these pieces of evidence can be handled. But the counsel should come up, if need be, vis-à-vis the judge, and that is in the first place the general court, because that's the court of final decision for the scrutiny of the evidence. They should convince that court that it was a reasonable inference to say that these persons were associated with the acts which are the cause for the listing on the sanctions regime. That's really how it goes. So the council must convince. Now, my impression is, but that's sort of my assessment of the case law in general, not specifically related to the Ukrainian case, is that the council learns rather quickly on the job. They have now many more cases where they win than in the first years after this Kadi case law. The Kadi case law started in 2008, was further developed in 2013, and in these years, the General Court confirmed by our court, in fact, annulled very, very many cases because they had not done the work of assembling the evidence, of reasoning, of defending properly in court, etc., etc. Now, they have become much, much smarter and more committed and applied. They know what the standard of judicial review will be, and they win many more cases.
Hello. Hello, Remo Hess from Swiss newspaper, Luzerner Zeitung and Aargauer Zeitung. I have a Swiss question, if I may. Within the negotiations of the institutional framework agreement, the European Commission and Switzerland are also negotiating about the creation of an arbitration court that could oversee these bilateral agreements and for dispute settlement. How much space or marge de maneuver do you see for such an arbitration court next to the European Court of Justice when it comes to European law or questions that touch the internal market or more in general, maybe also in view of Brexit, where are the limitations of an arbitration court next to the European Court of Justice?
Well, I have, of course, not seen the precise proposal to which you refer and what's now lying on the table. What I can say, however, is that, as you know, our court has handed down a decision that's formally called an opinion, but let's practically, it's not an opinion like an AG's opinion, it's a real decision on the so-called EEA court. This was December 1991, so it goes back rather long. So the court will never accept an involvement, that steady case law of another court and the Court of Justice to finally say what the law of the European Union is. Let that be very clear. However, there are examples, both in the sort of political practice and also in the case law, where a court system, a judicial system for interpreting a particular agreement has been accepted and validated by the court. And Not only that, there are now in force, as far as I know, two association agreements, one with Ukraine and one with Moldova, where there is an arbitration committee, and that arbitral committee itself can refer matters of union law to our court. So those are different things. So if you have a bilateral agreement which is supervised, and in case of litigation there is a conflict-solving mechanism through an ad hoc system, and this ad hoc system refers matters of union law to our court, but that's then the decision of that court, there is political precedent, but the mechanism was never used. So that is why a judge, as a judge, I cannot say what the fate of the mechanism is, whether these cases will be admissible, whether there will be challenge against the jurisdiction or the possibility to ask questions. In academia, in academic writing, that mechanism is mostly praised as something functional. And it is not, I mean, it's a bit technical what I'm now saying. If such an arbitration court makes a reference that is not a reference based on Article 267 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, because that is the internal mechanism to the European Union, and all the dialogue of which we now spoke extensively, of these national courts interacting with the Court of Justice. The legal basis for references for preliminary rulings on union law proper, asked by such an arbitration court, to call it now briefly that way, is the international agreement. And then the question arises, can such an international agreement add to the competences of our court? Or are the competences of our court limited to what is provided in the treaties on which the European Union is founded? That question is in academic writings controversial. But it's open. There is not a single case to answer it so far. One thing is sure. Direct ruling on union law proper by such an arbitration court is impossible. That is the old EEA decision. So I hope it's sufficiently clear. All of this is nuanced. It's not easy. I mean, I don't envy you, because it's not easy to write smart articles for the general public which do justice to all these subtleties of the law. But I explained actually the same for the German language program in Switzerland, Zehn vor Zehn, 10 days ago. So you still find it on their website.
I'm William Ellington, and I represent Evernow Publishing. For what seems like years, British politicians, some of them the Brexit types, have rabbited on about the European Court infringing the prerogatives of Parliament. Now, you've explained that there is a fairly fundamental clash between the way things are done. But what my question is, why did it take so long for parliamentarians to understand this? Why did they decide after decades to start complaining? Was there a decision of the court that particularly annoyed them?
I do not see immediately what this has to do with our jurisdiction of the Court of Justice, but maybe I missed some aspect of... do you have any idea, William?
No, I think that the question is whether a specific judgment or case law of the court triggered this reaction in the UK.
I'm not sure. It's No, no. I think it's, as I said, it's a structural problem. I have not a single judgment in mind. And by the way, this whole thing about the Court of Justice stopping an act of Westminster, do not forget that until the punchline of the 29th of March 2019, there are still cases brought from Britain over the reference for preliminary ruling procedures, even newly brought now, as though they were sort of doing it quickly still before it's too late to have our court pronounce on the European Union law relevance of cases, which are clearly cases controversial in national politics. So that is, you may have heard about our case Tele2, Sverige and Watson, a case of December 2016. Do you know how that case was initially named? Davis. You know who David Davis is? You know what that case decided? That European Union law was opposing an act of Westminster. So the case brought by this very person and by the deputy leader of the Labour Party, Tom Watson, aimed to obtain an interpretation of European Union law which would make it clear what they hoped for and what they asked for, that the law, that the Act of Parliament in Westminster was contrary to Union law, and therefore they had politically opposed, which is their good right to do so, the Act of Parliament. They had lost the vote in the Commons. They tried it over the courtway, and our court, following the normal process, decided the case, 21st of December 2016. That happens. So it's not always what people formally say that they are doing that they are in reality doing. That's all on public record. Huh? Simply read the judgment, 21st of December 2016. So there is sometimes a huge discrepancy to what you do at the front door, touring with a bus through the United Kingdom, and what do you do in the back door on the Kirchberg in Luxembourg. But the same people.
Todd Buell from Law 360 and MLEX. The commission now is working in some ways on taxes, you know, for example, taxing digital giants, you know, large technological companies, and working on VAT reform and things like that. I mean, what consequences could this have, or is maybe is this already having for the court? Thank you.
Well, of course, pending legislation, pending draft legislation, so to speak, has no direct bearing on the court's work yet. If any of these plans come to results, then of course it's always the same. You fall back on the two main roles of the court. First of all, the legislation may be challenged on its constitutionality, quote unquote, that is, on its compliance with primary law of the union. Is it within union competence? Have the right procedures been followed? Is it possibly against one or another fundamental right of the entities involved, etc., etc.? That's typical constitutionality review. And that comes over national courts normally, where cases are pending, for instance, taxes being due, being contested, and then in the framework of such litigation, all these cases go to the Court of Justice. So that is one aspect of jurisdiction after such legislation, but also the same applies for asylum and immigration. Think about a case we didn't speak about. It's Slovakia and Hungary, supported by Poland against counsel. A judgment of September 2017. It's an example of that type. So legislation is made to face a crisis, and then it's challenged in our court. So that's the first function or impact on our court. The second is, once the rules are validated, and to the extent they are, maybe they partly are and partly not. I mean, once you come over that first hurdle, then it's a matter of uniform interpretation, enforcement, and all of that. Because, of course, once the rule is on the books, it should also be applied in practice in an egalitarian way. And that's maybe very important for all of you dealing with our case law to realize. Our almost obsessive concern, I'm partly joking now, but our almost obsession with uniformity of union law has simply to see with equality before the law. If union law were to mean something different in Ireland and in Poland and in Belgium and in Greece and in Portugal, and I can multiply this with all the member states, then there is no equality of citizens, of undertakings, of states, of public interests, etc., etc., of consumers, of environmental interests, and so on, before union law. And that is the core principle of the union. Since the Lisbon Treaty, by the way, that is expressly stated in treaties. It's remarkable that between 1952 and 2009, the equality of the member states and their peoples, plural, before union law, was not expressly stated in the treaties. Now it is. And that is why the court has this important role to play.
Patrizia Antonini avec l'agence de presse italienne ANSA. Le gouvernement italien et la municipalité de Milan ont saisi la Cour et le tribunal européen avec le cas de la relocalisation de l'agence des médicaments européenne, la décision du conseil sur la relocalisation de Londres à Amsterdam. Et ils ont demandé d'annuler la décision. Est-ce que vous prévoyez qu'il y aura une voie prioritaire vu la deadline de la Brexit? Est-ce que vous pensez que c'est admissible? Qu'est-ce que sont les temps que vous prévoyez? Merci.
Bon, la seule chose que je peux dire à ce propos, parce que c'est un cas, comme vous le dites vous-même, hein, qui est pendant actuellement devant la Cour et le tribunal, c'est que l'affaire portée devant la justice de l'Union par l'Italie en tant qu'État membre est directement de la compétence de la Cour, parce que c'est une constellation État membre contre le Conseil. Tandis que la commune de Milan, ça c'est du ressort du tribunal. Et si je suis bien informé, le tout est concentré en concertation entre les juges et rapporteurs des deux juridictions devant la Cour. C'est la mise en œuvre de l'article 54 du statut de la Cour de justice. Ce qui veut dire que tant la demande en référé que les deux recours, donc tant de la commune de Milan que de l'Italie, sont maintenant pendants devant la seule Cour. Certes, en conséquence de cela, il n'y a pas le double degré de juridiction, mais il y aura tout de suite une décision finale, quelle qu'elle soit. La compétence en référé est passée donc du président du tribunal vers le vice-président de la Cour, parce qu'à la Cour, c'est le vice-président qui est l'instance compétente pour les demandes en référé. Et donc la demande en référé est pendante, celle-là évidemment sera décidée beaucoup plus rapidement, parce que c'est le propre d'un référé. Le sens est évidemment totalement imprévisible, l'affaire est pendante, et donc l'affaire devant la Cour suit son cours normal. C'est un recours direct, donc c'est une requête, un mémoire en défense, une réplique, une duplique, enfin c'est la procédure, donc c'est, on n'en est qu'au stade initial pour le moment. Hein.
Et l'avantage de ce que l'affaire du tribunal a été transférée à la Cour, c'est que devant le tribunal, la partie requérante, c'est la ville de Milan. Et maintenant, elle peut faire valoir ses arguments devant la Cour. L'alternative aurait été de suspendre le tout devant le tribunal. Ça. Et la ville de Milan n'aurait pas pu faire valoir ses arguments devant la Cour.
Oui, c'est ça.
À ce stade.
C'est donc, tout à fait, je suis entièrement d'accord avec le président Jäger, c'est donc un souci de bonne administration de la justice qui fait que tout est concentré devant une instance unique. C'est, oui.
Ok, dernière question, last question.
Merci beaucoup et merci beaucoup pour avoir fait le déplacement ici. Malheureusement, je n'ai pas une question sur la Constitution. Alors, c'est plutôt pour Monsieur le Président. Vous avez mentionné qu'il y a plus de juges. Et ça, c'est une bonne chose pour la Cour, pour le tribunal. Je voulais savoir, au niveau de votre organisation interne, le fait qu'il y a plus de juges, est-ce qu'il y a plus de possibilités d'avoir des grandes chambres? Et vous avez mentionné que vous avez une affaire pendante aux grandes chambres, à la grande chambre. C'est quel cas? Et juste si vous me permettez une deuxième question, et c'est le cas que vous avez mentionné avec l'Irlande et ce cas avec l'aide d'État. Alors, il y a un cas devant M. Lennart, c'est un pourvoir, c'est les États-Unis. Les États-Unis aimeraient bien intervenir dans ce cas. Et ça, c'est un pourvoir. De tribunal.
Dans quelle matière?
C'est le cas aide d'État avec l'Irlande.
Ah,
Apple.
Oui.
Apple, excusez-moi.
Non, attends.
Apple. Alors, la question pour moi, M. Jaeger, c'est ça fait 2 ans qu'on a l'audience dans cette affaire, 2 ans. Et est-ce que vous attendez une décision de la Cour sur le pourvoi des États-Unis avant que vous puissiez organiser des audiences.
Oui, parce que vous disiez qu'il savait 2 ans.
Excusez-moi, c'est pas. Excusez-moi, deux ans que ça a été déposé, introduit,
oui.
Et maintenant on attend les audiences et ça traîne un peu.
Première question, oui, le fait qu'on est passé de 28 à 46 juges en 2017, on était 46, et qu'on sera à 56 en 2019, augmente les possibilités de siéger en grande chambre. De ce point de vue-là, la réponse est certainement oui. Ça ne veut pas dire que c'est mathématique et qu'on aura une avalanche en grande chambre, c'est pas du tout ça. C'est en fonction du mérite de l'affaire qu'on passera ou qu'on ne passera pas en grande chambre. Vous me posez une colle, si je devais maintenant vous dire comme ça le nom de l'affaire qui est passée ou qui est maintenant jugée en grande chambre. C'est une entreprise, on vous fournira le nom plus tard. C'est en matière d'aide d'État. En tout cas, c'est oui. le fond de la... Maintenant, oui, toutes les affaires concernant les aides d'État ou tax rulings. Donc, il n'y a pas seulement l'affaire dont vous avez mentionné l'existence, il y en a d'autres, vous le savez très bien. Nous essayons d'avoir une vue d'ensemble sur la problématique pour éviter que dans une première affaire, on décide blanc et dans une deuxième peut-être... noir parce qu'il y a un élément qui a été mis sur la table dans cette affaire-là et qu'on n'avait pas vu dans la première affaire. Et donc, de ce point de vue-là, on essaye d'avoir la maturation plusieurs affaires en même temps pour ensuite aller en audience. Oui, je ne pense pas, mais je ne siège pas dans ces affaires, mais mon opinion personnelle, c'est que ça n'a rien à voir avec la demande d'intervention des États-Unis ou une éventuelle attente de quoi que ce soit sur cet aspect-là. Non. On essaye d'avoir ce souci de cohérence et comme c'est un domaine nouveau dans lequel l'Union européenne est devenue active, on veut donner une assise assez solide à nos premières décisions et ne pas faire l'improvisation. Les enjeux économiques sont quand même considérables. Donc, il faut peut-être réfléchir avant de décider.
Oui, je peux confirmer que la procédure sur pourvoi pour ce qui est du rejet de la demande d'intervention par les États-Unis devant le tribunal, maintenant je vois exactement à quoi vous faites allusion. En fait, c'est une procédure en pourvoi, pas comme une autre. Comme il s'agit d'un incident de procédure pendant que l'affaire continue au tribunal, ça se fait d'une manière assez rapide chez nous, et c'est du ressort du vice-président, et qui va traiter de ce pourvoi et ça va être décidé très vite. Donc ce n'est pas un pourvoi devant la grande chambre ou une chambre à 5 juges. Non, c'est parce que c'est en fait dans le cadre d'une procédure qui est encore en cours. L'affaire n'a pas encore, même pas partiellement, été liquidée. Hein, donc elle est pendante. Donc ça ne peut pas bloquer le cours devant le tribunal.
Merci.
Thank you very much, and please join us for a cup of coffee or refreshments next door. Thank you.
Very good.
Merci pour votre venue.
Merci à vous tous. Thank you to all.